I would just like to read three verses, which is in the book of Isaiah. And these are three verses that Aidan has chosen as well. And if you listen to these verses, you will think, well, this really seems a bit strange, and it doesn't sound logical. So it's Isaiah 55, the first three verses, and they go like this. Come, all you who are thirsty, come to the waters. And you who have no money, come, buy and eat. Come, buy wine and milk without money and without cost. Why spend money on what is not bread, and your labor on what does not satisfy? Listen to me, and eat what is good, and your soul will delight in the richest of fare. Give ear and come to me, hear me, that your soul may live. I will make an everlasting covenant with you, my faithful love, promised to David. May the Lord bless us today as we consider all the things that we're going to be saying about His Word. About 2,000 years ago, there is a place, if you drive about half an hour northeast of the city of Jerusalem today, where the river is, the Jordan River, there was something very interesting that happened about 2,000 years ago. There was this man called Jesus who was present, and his own, was it his cousin, who's John the Baptist? Yes, was his cousin. He was baptizing in the Jordan, and baptizing was, for some, a new thing. They didn't know what it was. And he wanted to he didn't want to baptize Jesus. Jesus actually came to him and said, "You need to baptize me." Now, this is ironic, Aidan. I don't know if you thought about this. Because I've been telling you all this time, baptism is an outward expression of your inward decision that you've made. And that is for a sinful person to be able to do the same thing as what Jesus did when he was crucified and resurrected. Throwing away the old sinful life and starting a new life in Christ. Well, Jesus wasn't sinful, and yet he had to be baptized 2,000 years ago. And so what happened was that him and John the Baptist went into the river Jordan, the two of them, and there John the Baptist did a baptism. A very important baptism. In fact, it was so important that when Jesus came back out of the water, it was like the heaven opened and there was a dove that came down from heaven. And there was a loud voice coming, I don't know, probably something like thunder or something, I don't know. But it must have been impressive. And God says, so that everybody who were there could hear, "This is my son, and I love him very much." Well, the thing is, we know that when Jesus was baptized, and we know that many things that this Jesus did were done because they needed to be an example for us. Jesus had no theological reason to be baptized because he had no sin in him. But yet, there he was. He got baptized. 2,000 years ago. The Bible tells us a number of different stories about baptism. And, you know, I always have this picture in my mind. I thought of bringing a picture like that, but I can explain it to you today. If you're in South Africa and you wake up in the morning and you have your morning coffee, then you have to have a rusk. I don't know if you have many rusks here in Scotland. I don't see them on the shelves, not the way we had them in South Africa. But these would be a nice, sizey, bulky, dry cookie or biscuit. Quite, you know, it's so dry, if you just had to bite it, it will just hurt your teeth. You had to dunk it into your coffee, and you go like this for a while until it softens. And then when it is nice and soft, you take it out, being very careful not to spill anything, and then they're very nice to eat. And this is what the word baptism reminds me of. The Greek for baptism is baptizo, and it basically means you have to dunk something into something else. You have to take the biscuit and put it inside. That's baptizo. And when we baptize someone, we have to do the same. Well, there was a good reason for that. And I will come to that good reason in a minute. But let me share one of those stories about baptism with you. It's a story that we find in the book of Acts in chapter 8. And there in Acts chapter 8, we have two people who are in the story. And I'm just going to read a few verses from there. Acts chapter 8, and I'm going to start with verse 26. And it says, "Now an angel of the Lord said to Philip, 'Go south to the road, the desert road, that goes down from Jerusalem to Gaza.' So he started out, and on his way he met an Ethiopian eunuch, an important official in charge of the treasury of Candace, queen of the Ethiopians. He was the treasurer of Ethiopia. He was the minister of finance. This man had gone to Jerusalem to worship, and on his way home was sitting on his chariot reading the book of Isaiah the prophet, the same book that we read from earlier. The Spirit told Philip, 'Go to that chariot and stay near it.' Then Philip ran to the chariot and heard the man reading Isaiah the prophet. And Philip says, 'Do you understand what you are reading?' 'How can I?' he said. 'Unless someone explains it to me.' So he invited Philip to come and sit with him." Now you can just imagine the two of them sitting side by side on this chariot, a scroll that is half rolled open like this, and they're busy reading the book of Isaiah. The eunuch was reading this passage of scripture, and it's from Isaiah chapter 53, just two chapters earlier from the one I read this morning. And it says, "He was led like a sheep to the slaughter, and as a lamb before the shearer is silent, so he did not open his mouth. In his humiliation, he was deprived of justice. Who can speak of his descendants? For his life was taken from earth." The eunuch then asked Philip, "Tell me please, who is this prophet talking about? Is it himself or is it someone else?" Then Philip began with that very passage of scripture and told him the good news about Jesus. So Philip started with Isaiah 53, and he told this minister of finance of Ethiopia the story of Jesus, the one who 2,000 years ago was baptized by his own cousin John the Baptist in the River Jordan. And as they traveled along the road, they came to some water. Water. And the eunuch said, "Look, here is water. Why shouldn't I be baptized?" And he gave orders to stop the chariot. Then both Philip and the eunuch, and that's why I have to do this as well today in the cold water, went down into the water, and Philip baptized him. Well, the thing is, I've been thinking about baptism for a bit. And as we will read, I'll just read three more verses from the book of Romans in a minute. But it's all about a funeral. It's all about a funeral. You bury the person. Now I suppose it will be difficult to do it in sand. You know, you might just bury the guy and then it take too long to get him out again. By the time you're done with that, you know, he's dead or something. So that's why water is a good alternative. You can go in and you can come out and there you are. The interesting thing about the story to me is that it was important that this minister of finance had to understand the story of Jesus before he could be baptized. It's important to me that when Jesus was baptized, he himself was probably about 25 or 26 years old. He had to have a knowledge of the reason why we get baptized. And that is important. And as it is the same for Aiden, who I don't see at the moment. Did he run away? Did he go and fetch his wetsuit or something? You know, he's still studying. And he was even asking me in this week, do you think I'm really ready to be baptized? Well, the interesting thing is that Jesus likens baptism in John chapter 3 to birth. He says, you have to be reborn, to Nicodemus. And Nicodemus says, reborn? Do you mean I have to go back into my mother's womb and come out again? He says, no, man, it's not like that. But the thing is, when you are being baptized, you have to understand what's going on, but you are a new baby. And you start something new. It needs to, you don't just leave a baby for a week and with a tin of baked beans and an opener and say, I'll see you next week. You can't do that. You have to wash it and care for it and change the nappies and, you know, all those things. And for as far as we can see, we will have a new baby on our hands and the whole of this congregation will have to look after him. I'm not changing the nappies every time. I've done it. No, I've never done it. Romans 6 gives us an explanation of what baptism is. In verse 1, Paul says, what shall we say then? Shall we go on sinning so that grace may increase? Now we know that grace only exists when the law has been broken. If you are in your car and you drive too fast on the motorway and the police stops you, they ought to be giving you a ticket. They ought to be fining you there. But if he says to you, look, you've been going at 90, but today I feel good, off you go. He's been gracious to you. He's given you grace. You can only have grace when you have committed sin against the law, so to speak. Yeah. He says, shall we go on sinning so that grace may increase? By no means. We died to sin. How can we live in it any longer? Or don't you know that all of us who were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? We were therefore buried with him through baptism into death, in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too may live a new life. If we have been united with him like this in his death, we will certainly also be united with him in his resurrection. We are going to commit a burial and the resurrection here today. So Aiden had this idea in his mind a while ago. I want to become a Christian, or I want to follow Christ. I want to find a way of doing that. And today the water is not magical or anything, really. Last night we struggled, but we got it full. And it's not magical. It's not going to change him suddenly. He's not going to start behaving or anything like that. I hope he will. He's not here to hear all this stuff. But he's made this decision a while ago already. And what we do today is we have an outward expression of that inward decision that he's made a while ago. We're going to be burying Aiden, and there will be a resurrection in the likeness of Christ. This same Christ who in the beginning of his ministry went to the Jordan River and was baptized by John the Baptist. At the end of his ministry, they killed him. They nailed him on a cross, put that cross up so that everybody could see who he was. They put a sign above his head that said, this is the King of the Jews. And that's where he died, alone. And they buried him. And you know what? That was the Friday afternoon. On the Sunday morning, when they wanted to go and attend to his grave, a few ladies with flowers and things that smell nice, they went into that grave only to find some linen lying around there. He was not there. He was resurrected because he had victory over Satan and over sin. He had it because it's just impossible for us to really have it. And he needs to be our big brother in this. And that's why he had to make an example of being baptized himself. And says to us, why don't you just do the same? It shows everyone what you have decided. Bury yourself, be resurrected, new life is about to start. Yes? Aiden, I think you must come and join me in the front here. Come and stand over on this side, please, and then you look at everybody. Yeah, we've been talking about this for a while, didn't we? Aiden is going to make a vow today. It's a profession of faith. We've been talking about this for some weeks and so on. And I'm going to ask him to do this in public, in front of everybody. And when he does this, then we will all be too happy to, after your swim, after your baptism, to invite you as a member of this congregation, if that is what you want to do. Okay? So I'm just going to read three of these to you, and I would like for you to answer at the end of each of these three sentences. The first one: do you accept Jesus Christ as your personal Savior and Lord, and do you desire to live your life in a saving relationship with Him? Well, this guy is very decided. Do you accept the teachings of the Bible as expressed in the Statement of Fundamental Beliefs of the Seventh-day Adventist Church? And do you pledge by God's grace to live your life in harmony with these teachings? Okay. And then, do you desire to be baptized as a public expression of your belief in Jesus Christ, to be accepted into the fellowship of the Seventh-day Adventist Church, and to support the church and its mission as a faithful steward by a personal influence, tithes and offerings, and a life of service? Fantastic. Thank you. That's good. Usually people just say, yes, yes, yes. That's fantastic. I really appreciate that. Now, you've all heard that. This guy is in it. He's not going anywhere. For those of you who don't know, this building is now, what, about on its way to be 2 years old, I would say, Grace? 3 years old, almost. Two and a half. Yeah. Much of what caused this building to exist is the money that we all bring every week, like we did this morning. So, and I just needed to let you know, because every week when we take up a tithe or an offering, that is money that goes to the working of the church, you know, for coffee and for food and for warm water, hopefully it's still warm, and so on. And so this is the kind of influence. Want your money. I used to belong to a church in South Africa, which, if you were saying the abbreviation of the church, sounded like, please give, you know, and we were making jokes about that. That's not all that church is about. But it's really your influence in every other sphere as well. It's not just money. So I would like to pray to God later on that He will bless you in that sense, and that we can, and we will make use of you more than you probably think at the moment. So it's very good to hear. Okay, so now I'm going to invite you to go into your little room on that side. You're on this side, sorry. And I'm there, and I'll meet you inside here. Okay. Now, look that way. We're going to do this later. Turn this way first. You want to speak first.
Sure.
Yeah. Because I think, you know, having standing here for a little while, now I'm feeling a lot more easy with the water. And if you take 2 or 3, 5 minutes to say something, you will also feel a lot better about the water, won't you?
Yeah, of course.
Okay, here we go. We got to listen to this man.
Well, around about 2 years ago, probably 2 years ago, started happening. I was a really rebellious nature. Started having what are commonly known as abduction experiences, and these things put fear and instilled fear into my life, and I never realised, I never knew what was going on, and I always knew that something had been put in me, and I was never really in control of myself, and my emotions and my thinking, and for a long time, about a year, I really investigated to find out what is really going on and the truth to what has happened to me. And I became so embroiled in fear that I used to stay up all night. I would not be able to sleep. I would stay up till 6 in the morning till the sun rose, and then I would feel safe to go to sleep. I was and petrified, and I ended up going out a lot more often and doing more drugs and more drinking to try and escape the fear of living through the week. And basically, things just got worse and worse, and it got to a stage where I was really ready to end my life. I was ready to kill myself. I thought there was no hope for anything. There was no way of getting out of this. There's nothing I could do. And I remember, I always knew there was a spiritual sort of thing with this, because I would always be able to feel that these presences around me and the supernatural stuff going on, and I used to think that perhaps they were invisible to us and we couldn't see these creatures. And I lived a life of terror, and I thought I was ready to end my life. And I completely rejected God. I wanted nothing to do with God. I didn't believe in God. I thought it was a complete joke. And if you would have said to me that Jesus died for me and came to save my life, I would have laughed in your face, to my shame. Yeah. But even in that hardened heart of unbelief, something told me to pray. Even when I would have went round and said, look, God doesn't exist, because this is going on with my life. And I'm telling you right now, there's something else. And something in me just yearned to pray. And I prayed, and God answered my calling. And I began to see things differently. I began to see what was really going on. And I thought that I was, through the experiences I had, I was able to commune and have been able to see the spirits of the so-called deceased. And basically what happened was I prayed for truth, and God showed me things, and very, very quickly I began to, I believe it was the end of the year 2014, just before Christmas, I began to see things a lot differently. And on the 11th of January the following year, I had this experience, was it's common, and there was this presence over me, you know, and I've been just messed with in my bed. I've been able to sleep at night, and it was just completely demoralizing, and I'd just given up, and I really cried in my bed and prayed inside me. I never even spoke words. I really prayed in a faith that was almost, I've not really truly got back to that calling of faith. I guess I was at the point of, if this didn't work, I was dead. There's no point in continuing. And I just cried with everything that was in me. And in a blink of a moment, after about 5 minutes of deeply crying to Jesus, even when I didn't even believe in Jesus, this presence, it was almost as if something grabbed what was there and just threw it. And I was in my lying in my bed, and the spirit that was in me, where I was cleansed in an instant, and I would just remain lying, shaking in my bed, and crying with joy and with excitement. And I never knew what was going on. My head was so messed that I ended up thinking a blasphemous thought upon the Lord after a while. And as soon as I thought that, this presence was gone. And since then, I knew the first thing I needed to do was get a Bible. And I started reading the Bible. When I read the Bible from, I had it in my some thought in my mind that if I read the Bible from start to finish, that was me. That's all I had to do. And I read very quickly, but I got the understanding of the whole great controversy. But I've never really in depth studied the Word of God with prayer and true communion with God. And it took a long time, and around a year. And I was always, through my research, always knew that the Seventh-day Adventist Church had, I became aware of the things of the papacy, you know, and all these sorts of scenarios and all these things, and understanding all this, started to piece together all the elements to make up what was going on in my life. And I understood things I understood how the world truly worked. And the first actual minister that I got to me was a Baptist preacher, and he came to my home, And my father was there, and we discussed things. And I'd explained all these situations, you know, and I'd have these out-of-body experiences, and I'd even seen, they'd even tried to deceive me. For these fallen angels tried to deceive me into thinking they were these intelligent beings with advanced technology. And then the next deception was that they were that there was a spirit of a dead man. And I saw this man several times. I was not sleeping or anything. I was just sitting in my room, and just in a blink of an eye, when this presence came to me, I would be outside of my body. Of course, we all know that your spirit is not a separate thing. Your soul is, we are a living soul, a whole makeup. But they tried to put a hypnotic implant in me and to try and make me think that I could have some sort of out-of-body experience and traverse around my home. And I would be in one room and in the next room, and I'd be back in my room. And this presence would be around me, you know. I would see a man, and I knew that it was trying to, this was the next stage of it, trying to it's Satan trying to play mind games with. And the fallen thing that I knew, and that was one of the basis for this church, for I knew that this church had a doctrine on the state of the dead, and that is that when we die, we go to sleep until Christ will return at the end of time, at the close of probation. And I thought, and I knew that was the truth, because I knew that these were trying to deceive me. And they stopped doing that. And basically, I got in touch with Jim after a long time, and something really wanted, I was trying to come to the church for a long time, and I was really held back from doing this. I never even wanted to leave my room. I was so enclosed in my room with torment, and I wouldn't leave my room at all. And it took me actually a good few months to even get in touch with Pastor Jim. And then from then on, I've been finding God, and I've had a walk with God that I never knew was possible, and joy that I've never known one could have. And one thing I know about God is, even though I've taken things out on Him, you know, Satan likes to try and manipulate our minds and to put a cloud over our minds and to get us to blame God for our problems. But even blaming God and rebelling against God, He's always welcome. He's always been there to welcome this filth that I am back, this sinful man that I am back, into His loving arms, and to be there to strengthen me and to always protect me. And I've even found I found just amazing things. You know, I like to sing hymns on my own. For when these presences are around me, Ellen White says, when you sing to God and you give glory to God, if you read the Old Testament, you see how the armies of Israel, they put the choir in front so they would win the battle. And you think that in your mind, why would you put people who sung to God in front of the soldiers? Because they were praising God. And I found that just even singing to God, these presences go away. And I've now, at this stage in my life, I'm still battling through. And but I've entered a whole new chapter of my faith. I've began to see that what Jesus meant of your own selves, you can do nothing. And I've been trying to do to solve my problems in my own strength, rather than surrendering to God. And I've been asking God to truly help me die to myself, that He may take control of the things and take care of me. And He's worked wonders, and I've really had a new chapter in my life. And I can now say with all my heart that the best moments of my entire life have been in communion with God. And nothing has compared to anything that is, the world has not been able to give that. And I would just like to read a chapter, a verse from Scripture. And it's 1 Peter 4, and verse 12. And it says, "Beloved, think it not strange concerning the. Forgive me. I realised my name is Aidan, and it's actually an Irish name, and it actually means the fiery one. And I thought it very interesting because in 1 Peter 4 and verse 12 it says, "Beloved, think it not strange concerning the fiery trial which is to try you." So in other words, think it not strange why these things are happening to you, which is to try you, as though some strange thing that happened to you, unto you. In verse 13, "But rejoice, inasmuch as ye are partakers of Christ's sufferings, that when his glory shall be revealed," and we know his glory is God's character, "that when his character shall be revealed in us, ye may be glad also with exceeding joy." And I can say with my whole heart amen to that, because he's done exactly as always. So that's my testimony, and thank you all for being here.
Amen, thank you. 3 minutes, well used. That was fantastic. Come this way a bit. This pool is being used today for the first time. Thank you to you. And it is every one of the church members who came in here and saw it open said, "It's bigger than we thought it's going to be." Yeah. And Hadas, I just wanted to do a few laps this morning. But now we get to the true reason why we are in this place. Yeah. When we designed this church, and we asked the architect, "Can you draw us a baptismal pool?" He had no idea what that was. We had to do a lot of research for him, and that's where we ended up being. And it is such a privilege to bury you today, to baptize Aidan Hughes, because of the decision that you have made to follow the Lord.
Yes.
Now, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Well done, man. Congratulations. Have to go. Get yourself.
At this point, I'll ask Aidan to come forward.
Well, come and stand over here on that side. Thank you, Aidan. Because you are now again in the spotlight. The Seventh-day Adventist Church is the largest Protestant denomination in the world. We have about 20 million members on the books all over the world in more than 200 countries, and probably about 30 million attendees who are not members yet, who are regular attendees in this church. So you can imagine, you know, what a big number 50 million is at the moment. And no wonder then that this is probably the biggest Protestant denomination in the world. Now, the highest level of decision-making in such a big church lies with the local congregation. And those kind of decision-making the stuff we make all these high-level decisions on is mainly membership. We decide on this level when somebody becomes a member. I know it sounds a bit like a club-type thing, but it's not really that. It's so that, and I've explained this to Aidan before, it's so that we want to protect, in a big, worldwide, complex church, the integrity of the church. And we want people to become members of our church. And so that when, for instance, if Aidan wants to move to America because there's a job for him or something like that, then he can move his membership across to America and they will know Aidan was a good member in regular standing here in Dunfermline. He was always active. When he lands there, they will say, "Ah, we see you were a deacon. Come and be a deacon with us. And we want you to fulfill that role." So there's lots of organization. And we're going to do a little bit of that just now. And it's very, very simple. And I'm going to propose to the congregation that we accept Aidan today as a member of the Dunfermline Church. And then I'm going to ask if there's someone who would like to second my proposal. Yes, there is. Is there any discussion You know, because this is a democratic society in a way, and we need to discuss, do you really want Aidan to be a member of our church? Well, is there anybody who would like to go against that? You know, they always do this. Yeah. Can I maybe see the hands of all of those of you who are members who would like to vote him in? Aidan, you must look at that, because this is your church. They have voted you in just now as a member of this congregation. Of all the people who are sitting in this building, probably only half are actually members of this particular congregation. And so I thank you very much for those of you who have been voting. And it looks like I have the good news of announcing that our newest member in this congregation is Aidan Hughes. Now, please stand where you are. Charles has something.
As the head here of the church, it's my privilege to be the first one to welcome you to the fellowship here. So we have certificates to verify that you're baptized, and some gift here as well. It's my privilege to welcome you.
Thank you.
This is a toolkit to help you start. Giving to new mothers to the babies in hospital when they come out. So our new baby also has the toolkit here, so it's starting off, so it's just like a little bit very useful for you. And so now we're going to, at this point, we're going to have our closing hymn, and fasting, we'll give a benediction. And then after that, we'll invite everybody who wants to, like everyone, to come up and to also welcome Aidan into our fellowship here. And congratulate him on the wonderful.
Let's just close our eyes. Dear Lord, we thank you for this beautiful experience we've just had, the burial of an old person and the birth of a new. And may we all do this in our own lives today. Throw away that which is old and which doesn't fit with you anymore, and start new lives today. And Lord, we thank you that you've made it all possible because you died on the cross, and because of that, we can claim victory with you. Lord, for all of us who are here today, I pray, Holy Spirit, as we leave this place now, that you will be with us and guide us and protect us with your presence until Jesus comes. And until then, in Jesus' name, amen. Amen.